Good morning, church. Please rise, clap your hands for me. Romans 8, 38, 9 says, "For I am convinced nothing in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God." Amen. Amen.
Rich and poor, well, it don't matter. Weak us strong. You know, love is what we're after. We're all broken, but we're all in this together. God knows we stumble and fall. He so loved the world, he sent his son to save us all. And all the people said amen. Oh, and all the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord for his love never ends. And all the people said amen. Blessed are the poor and spirit who are the poor. Blessed are the persecuted in the poor in heart. Blessed are the people hungry for the bread and the star. For there is the kingdom of God. And all the people said amen. Whoa. Said amen. And all the people said amen. Oh, and all the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord for his love never ends. And all the people said amen. And all the people said amen.
Amen.
We believe in God the Father. We believe.
and he's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that he conquered death. We believe in the resurrection. And he's coming back. He's coming back again. Coming back again. We believe. We believe.
Amen.
Jesus Messiah, the Lord of all. Jesus Messiah, Lord of all. You're the Lord.
I can only imagine.
Yes, Lord, we can only imagine what a wonderful day that will be when we all see each other in heaven for eternity. Now we just ask that you bring the Holy Spirit in this place today. We ask that you be with Pastor Eddie as he brings the message. We thank you for all you have done, for all our blessings, Lord, in your name.
I pray that you came here today with a great expectancy to have God move and live and have his being in you and me. Amen? Because God's in the business of making himself an absolute reality in people's lives. He's just not a nice story in a book. And we're going to see some amazing things as we just experienced. And so what I want us to do is take a moment, turn around, and just say, listen, I have a great expectancy for God to move in your life, all right? School, they're already exiting the building. Middle school, high school, just feel free to stand up. I'm on. My pack is on. I got a new battery.
He's in the monitor.
But anyway, my voice carries, so it'll be all right. Well, listen, yes, thank you. Come on up. That was my next. I tell you, there isn't anything that gives me more joy to do is to have the opportunity to dedicate a new, beautiful, God, fearfully, wonderfully made child. Oh, look at that guy, little mustache. You know, the Bible teaches us that this is probably one of the most ancient practices the body of Christ does. We see that Abraham dedicated Isaac. Isaac dedicated Jacob. Jesus was dedicated in the temple. And for thousands and thousands and thousands of years, God's people have gathered and we have said, okay, Lord, this is your child. You have fearfully and wonderfully made this child. It is a gift to us as parents to be stewards of this great gift. And we need all the help we can possibly get. Because it's insane trying to raise a child. And I've had three boys of my own. They're all grown men now. And I'm telling you, it's insane. And so we love the fact that we have this opportunity as a family to come alongside. And this family and the child and be a tremendous witness for the Lord. And pretty much, let me just, a quick little background on baby dedication. We don't do baby baptisms. One is that we don't see any biblical reference to it in the Bible. None of the biblical heroes ever baptized infants. Now, what I mean by baptizing an infant is we're basically saying that ultimately baptism, as we understand Scripture say, is that ultimately a person has made a decision to repent from their sins and to now follow Jesus for the rest of their life. And so we understand that infants and babies aren't capable of doing such a thing. Not till they get older and understand their behavior and such and such. And so we don't do baby baptisms. We do baby dedications as the Bible lays out. And baby dedication is pretty much for the parents, because I'm sure 20 years from now, he's probably not going to have not one memory of this at all. Now, I was baptized when I was a child because my family came out of partly a Catholic background, and I saw a picture of me when I was a baby, but I have no memory of it. It was a wonderful experience for my parents, but it actually meant nothing to me when I was a child. I got older, and I got water baptized as an adult when I gave my life to Jesus. And so our goal here as a baby dedication is to say that we're going to raise this child in the ways of the Lord, and that when he gets old enough, that he'll be able to make a decision on his own whether to follow Jesus. Amen? And so we're going to pray. We're going to ask God's blessing. And we made up this nice little certificate here. It's going to be awesome to remember this day. And we have here Damian Tyler Guzman. Did I say that right? I usually get it all wrong. But that mustache there, you look like me 50 years ago. No, okay. Did I say that? All right. So if you wouldn't mind, we're just going to extend our hands, and we're going to ask a blessing over Damian and the family. Yeah, amen. Yeah, buddy. Awesome. You are awesome. Father. Father, we thank you, Lord. Father, for Damian, we thank you for his life. We thank you that you have fearfully and wonderfully made him. We thank you, Lord, that you have called him out and you have given him a purpose. Your word says that from his mother's womb, he has a purpose and a destiny that you have laid out for him to fulfill, and that lives will be changed and history will be changed, Lord, because of faithful service to you. We pray your protection over him. We pray, Father, for the parents as well. Bless them. Give them the wisdom and the patience, Lord, to be able to instruct this child in the ways of Jesus, Lord, that he would follow him all the days of his life. We pray, Father, that you would protect him, Lord, from the many wicked things that are out there in culture and society right now, Lord, in the world. We pray, Father, you would just have your angels round about him, that you would give him a true zeal for you. We ask this in Jesus' precious and blessed name. Amen. All right, yes, you had about enough, didn't you, huh, Damian? After that, all right, thank you. Thank you, guys. Awesome, awesome, awesome. All right. I'm just going to mention two things quickly. If you take out this weekend program, there's about 30 things in here that are just absolutely wonderful things. I can't hit upon them all, so I'm just going to ask you just to take some time and really kind of go through it, because there's probably stuff that you'd love to get involved in and allow God to use you. I'm just going to tell you right now, pull out this weekend connection card. It's a pink sheet. And do me a favor, whether you're a first-time guest, returning guest, or one of our regulars, please fill this out, name, email, address, and just put it into one of those offering boxes that you see in the corners of the worship center here. And I'm just going to say quickly about the offering, don't feel any obligation to give to the offering. This offering is for those of us who consider New Hope our home. If you're a guest, a returning guest, our heart and our desire for you is that you would have a wonderful experience in God. Through worship, through prayer, through the reading of the word, through the fellowship of the body of believers, that you would be able to have an encounter with God from the minute you came on to this property until eventually you move and go out into the world. And so please, this is a great opportunity for us to get to know you, you to know us, and so fill that out. On the back, though, a prayer request is probably one of the main things I hit every week, the back of that connection card, because every Monday night, I and your pastors and your leaders, we pray over every single one of these requests. And then after we pray for them, we give them to our prayer warriors and intercessors, and they pray over every single one of these requests. And I'm telling you, there is just a huge labor of prayer coming alongside you. And because of that, this is what we've experienced. God supernaturally, because he's real and he's alive and he desires to be proactive in your life, he answers prayer. Isn't that awesome? God answers prayer. This is just from last week. I'm just going to give you some back of the praise reports we got from last week. One was, thank you for your prayers. My biopsies all returned back benign. Isn't that awesome? All right. Another one, thank you for your prayers because My job search came in, and I finally got a job. All right, because everybody needs a job. Amen. Another one. Thank you for your prayers, because I've gotten a part-time employment, and my finances are better. And so, praise the Lord, we're going to pray for full-time employment. Amen, because we're going to believe God for that. This is one of my favorites here. Thank you for your prayers. My sister accepted the Lord as her Savior 2 weeks ago, and has found it in her heart through the Holy Spirit to forgive. Ooh, that must be another. Amen. All right, listen. It's just an awesome thing. One last thing here. In your weekend program is this connection card. This little card, it says fifth quarter. And I'm just going to mention quickly, this is coming out of Rooted Student Ministries for our high schoolers. And pretty much, Northport High, anybody heard of the Bobcats football team? Bobcats, anybody? Okay. All you Port Charlotte Pirate guys, just calm down. Anyway, they have four home games a year. And when they have a home game here in Northport, you get about a couple of thousand kids who come out for the game, and they hang out, and then after the fourth quarter the game is over, you got 2,000 kids running around Northport trying to figure out what to do. And what ends up happening is a lot of times they get into trouble. And so, or they try to find some type of entertainment, which usually kind of potentially leads them to drugs or alcohol or smoking or whatever. And so what the leadership at Rooted Student Ministries is that we want to provide a fifth quarter, and that provides a safe, sober environment here at New Hope right after the game to do all kinds of events and let these kids come to a safe place where they can interact. And they're partnering with drug-free youth, I think, D5, drug-free youth, and other organizations and businesses to be able to provide free food and just a wonderful opportunity. They're going to share a quick message with them to really kind of let them know a little bit about the potential of having faith in their life. It's going to be an awesome thing. This is why I make a big push. One, I want you to find a teenager, high school. We're not doing middle school. It's the first time we're doing it, and we don't know really what the potential is, and we're not going to be able to handle both middle and high school, so we're just targeting high school for right now, and we'll see what the Lord leads after that, but high school. So put this in the hand of a high schooler. That would be great. Thank you very much for that. Second thing is that we want to have enough adults here so that the building's still here when we come to service Saturday night. So if you wouldn't mind, if you have a Friday night open, there's dates on this card that you really could come and help out. We could really, really, I know Anthony, raise your hand in the back. Just see Anthony, and he'd love to get you to help out on Friday night, just four times out of the year. It's just a wonderful opportunity, and you'd really be able to invest in kids. All right. Where are my little ones?
Got the joy down in.
Down in my heart. Where?
Down in my heart to stay.
You got the joy down in my heart. Where?
Down in my heart.
Where?
Down in my heart. I've got the joy
down in my heart. Where?
Down in my heart to stay.
Well, listen, we love children here at New Hope, and we bring them forward because Jesus told us in the scriptures not to hinder the little ones from coming. And we know they like to run around and jump and those types of things. And we say that's okay because Jesus said it was okay. So we say it's okay. And we don't expect little ones to act like 40-year-olds, right? We hope 40-year-olds act like 40-year-olds. So, but anyway, we want to bless them before they go to their classrooms. So if you wouldn't mind just extending your hand towards the children. Father, thank you, Lord, for these children. Thank you, what a gift they are. We pray your blessing over their lives. We thank you, Lord, for the parents. Bless them, O God. And Father, thank you, Lord, for all the children and youth workers that prepared lessons all week long to invest in these children, the deep truths of God and the gospel of Jesus Christ. We thank you, Lord, for that in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. All right. I love that mustache. I'm going to grow mine back.
job is not done in the world that Christ gave us to do, and the mandate is still binding on us today. That's why we speak of unreached people groups. But the missions is the back-breaking, culture-penetrating, darkness-shattering initial work to penetrate, plant the church, see it flourish, get its own elders, train its own people, evangelize its own networks. That's the task of missions. It's not over. And that Jesus Christ is the only way to heaven. And the alternative is hell. And millions and millions and millions of people are on their way there. And we have the only means of escape in our heads and in our hearts. Jesus Christ.
There are many prodigal sons. On our city streets they run, searching for shelter. And there are homes broken down, people's hopes have fallen to the ground. Failures.
So count the cost, brothers and sisters. This is not an invitation to an easy life. For 2,000 years, thousands and thousands of missionaries, the unnamed, no biographies written about them, just unnamed people of whom the world is not worthy, have counted this cost and put their lives at risk and reached the lost with the only message of salvation.
Friends, the hour of our day is desperate. And unless God moves, you and I are living in a world that is hopeless. And I want you to be able to leave here with a great hope. And that's going to require you and me to respond to a great God. Now, before we go any further, let's pause and invite the Holy Spirit to come to teach us what he would want us to learn through the ancient truths of the Bible. Amen? Let's bow our heads and pray. Father God, help us to remember, Lord, that it is not by our knowledge or by our persuasiveness that people get saved or healed, but it is by the power of the message of the gospel itself in your Son, Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord God, that it is not based on my strength or our wisdom, or our ability, or our power, but totally in your hands, because you are faithful. So, Lord, we give you all the praise and all the honor. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. I want you to just kind of think with me for a moment. Have you ever noticed the anti-Christian rhetoric in our generation? It's an interesting thing. In the name of education and advancement, educators and intellectuals have dismissed the most influential book ever from our curriculum, which makes it nearly impossible to understand the writings of Milton, Shakespeare, and Chaucer without having some basic understanding of Scripture. And yet, in our day, when censorship is decried by our news media and scholars and intellectuals and liberals, they are the ones who are the proponents to censor the Bible from the realm of public education. The result has been devastating, to say the least. By dumbing down our nation economically, politically, socially, and morally. So we have become a nation of people simply full of good man-made ideas that has literally left us polarized as a nation, divided and visionless, instead of us being a nation of people of God ideas that was the foundation of a radical transformation for these 13 weak little colonies to become the most powerful, influential nation in our time. What has happened? Now, for this reason and many, many more is why I am kicking off part 3 of our study through the book of Acts called Transformed by the Gospel. Because transformation is what we are destined for, which begins with new life. This new life is the only one thing that could ever fill all the empty spaces in our lives. It is what I'm going to say, it can forgive our past, it can secure our future in Christ Jesus. We who were condemned are now justified. We who were once sinners are now sanctified. And we who were once without hope now will one day be glorified in God. And so as we examine today's scriptures, let us explore the power of being gospel transformed by the reasoning of God's word. Well, how? Because our hearts will be gripped by the lostness of people for whom Christ died for. And I believe this is best understood when you and I consider how the power of the message of the gospel is this: Jesus Christ crucified and resurrected. Boom, exclamation point, done. Why is this so important for you and me to know? Because we simply need to put the gospel back on the road again, and not just within the four walls of our buildings, so that once again you and I will become jealous for God's glory and not political correctness that just dumbs us down anyway. Amen? Now, there probably isn't a better passage than the one that we're going to address today in Acts chapter 17, if you wouldn't mind turning with me. And I'm just going to tell you right now, Acts chapter 17, when you read through this passage, what you're going to see is that what happened 1,000 years ago in a culture wrestling with cultural issues and ethnical issues and financial issues and political issues, you know what? They are so similar to the issues that you and I are facing right now in our generation and in our culture and in our country. And I want you to see that the Word of God was just as powerful and practical 2,000 years ago as it is today. And that being said, that means there are things in this book that are going to be life-transforming in our life. And Paul is going to lay that out for you and me. And I just want to invite you to take this journey as we go and look at how God used a Paul to be able to influence and transform not only his own family, not only his own culture, not only his own city, but actually the world. And we're going to look at that. Acts chapter 17, and we'll start with verse 16. It says, while Paul was waiting for them in Athens, all right, he's in Athens, that's in Greece. Just saying. Supposed to be funny. Yes, it wasn't. All right. He was greatly distressed to see that the city was full of idols. So he reasoned, and I would circle that word in your Bible, he reasoned in the synagogue with the Jews and God-fearing Greeks, as well as in the marketplace day by day with those who happened to be there. A group of Epicureans and Stoic philosophers began to dispute with him. Some of them asked, what is this babbler trying to say? Others remarked, he seems to be advocating foreign gods. They said this because Paul was preaching the good news, and this is why they were getting all upset. He was preaching the good news about Jesus and the resurrection. Then they took him and brought him to a meeting of the Areopagus, where they said to him, may we know what this new teaching is that you are presenting. I want you to just kind of think about this for a moment. It's okay that Paul could go there and talk about all kinds of things, but the minute he started talking about Jesus and the resurrection, that changed the whole playing field. I want you to just kind of keep that in the back of your mind, because, my friends, I believe that is the issue of the day. May we know that what this new teaching is that you are presenting. You are bringing some strange ideas to our ears, and we want to know what they mean. All the Athenians and the foreigners who lived there spent their time doing nothing but talking about listening to the latest ideas. It's kind of like Facebook on Mars Hills. Verse 22, Paul then stood up in the meeting of the Areopagus and said, "Men of Athens, I see that in every way you are very religious, for as I walked around and looked carefully at your objects of worship, I even found an altar with this inscription to an unknown God. Now what you worship as something unknown, I'm going to proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth, and does not live in temples built by hands. And he is not served by human hands as if he needed anything, because he himself gives all men life and breath and everything else. From one man he made every nation of men, that they would inhabit the whole earth, and he determined the time set for them and the exact places where they should live. God did this so that men would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him, though he is not far from each one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being. As some of your own poets have said, we are his offspring. Therefore, since we are God's offspring, we should not think that the divine being is like gold or silver or stone, an image made of man's design and skill. In the past, God overlooked such ignorances, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent, for he has set a day when he will judge the world with justice by the man he has appointed. He has given proof of this to all men by raising him from the dead. When they heard about the resurrection of the dead, some of them sneered, but others said, we want to hear you again on this subject. At that, Paul left the council. A few men became followers of Paul and believed. Among them was Dionysus, members of the Areopagus, and a woman named Damaris, and a number of others. All right. Let me just give you a quick little backdrop here in chapter 17. Paul now has taken the gospel on the road. And he's on the road. And he's going to different cities. And the first thing that he does is that he reasons. He goes and he reasons. He goes to the synagogue. He reasons with the Jews. And then he reasons with any other God-fearing people of that particular culture and nature that is there. And then he goes to the marketplace right in the center of town where all the business and the life of that city and culture is being done. And he begins to reason once again. And we're going to talk about what this word reason means. Now, every time he goes to a different city, one city, they got all upset, and they stoned him. They brought him outside the city, and supernaturally, he survived the stoning. Another city, they got so upset at him that the people there had to have him go down a rope on the wall to escape. And as he's doing this, he comes to Athens. And I just want to suggest, as we read here in the text, it says here that Paul says that God has ordered the steps. And I want to suggest to you that God had been leading him ultimately to come to Athens. And I want you to picture this in your mind for a moment, because Athens was the epic center of that day of the intellectuals and philosophers and all the great scholars of the day were coming from Athens. All the new ideas and all the sciences and everything, all of human thought was flowing from Athens. And specifically, the center of this, the Areopagus, or you'll see another name for that called Mars Hill, all right, where basically all these intellectuals, I mean, just think of all the greatest colleges here in the United States, all coming together on this one spot, and all the professors and scholars are all reasoning and giving all their human effort. And here they drag Paul to Mars Hill, to the center. And And not because they, I mean, think about this. They've heard all kinds of thoughts and gods. I mean, these were very religious people. They it's not that they didn't believe in God. They had all kinds of gods. Now, even they said, well, maybe just in case we forgot one, let's just have a statue for an unknown god. I mean, God, they were covering every one of their bases. And then Paul comes in, and he does something that totally rocks their boat. I'm going to pull three things I want to show us in the text that Paul does that I believe that was so powerfully influential in that day is just as powerful, influential in our day should we follow in the steps of our master. And let's look at that. Verse 17, it says, so he reasoned in the synagogues and the Jews, the God-fearing Greeks, as well as in the marketplace. And I want to say, in the marketplace. And I think this is important. I think it's strategic. I believe God was leading him to Athens because God was going to deal with the issues of the day. I want you to understand that God's not afraid of culture and all of our professors and scholars and all these big institutions that come out with all this cycle babble stuff, whatever. You know what I mean? And all of a sudden we have to put our heads in the ground. Like, oh, you know, we're so afraid. And I want you to see how God intentionally leads Paul to the center of all of that. And with the message of Jesus and the resurrection, it throws them all into an uproar. I want you to see that all the wisdom of man is nothing in comparison to the weakness of God's little finger. We, if God does have a weakness, I don't think he does, but this is a metaphor. And in the midst of that, here comes Paul with a singular message. And I want you to see that he's leading him to the marketplace. And I want you to see that our tendency, because the tendency in our culture, in our society, tendency that I have and you have is the tendency to say, well, you know, the world is so corrupt. The ideas are so big. They're so pervasive. Let's just huddle in little groups and hide and wait till Jesus to come back. You're not going to read that in the scripture ever. God's not calling us to hide. He's not calling us to be the tail. He's calling you and me to be the head. He's calling you and me to stand out on a hill as a beacon of God's light in the midst of their darkness. God's called us to be his hands and feet, to come forth and bring the gospel, not to bring our preconceived lecturing ideas of what we think everybody should be doing, but to do as Paul does in the marketplace. Paul had a singular purpose. He didn't talk about himself. He didn't talk about his culture. He didn't talk about how great his church was. He didn't talk about how great his denomination is. He didn't talk about how great his country is. He talked about Jesus, crucified, resurrected. And that made all the intellectuals and the culture cringe. Why? That's the question you and I need to ask. That's the question you and I need to leave here today and get an answer by the grace of God. And I want to just suggest to you that here it says that when Paul went around the city, I want you to see, he had certain practices in his life. Paul didn't go and hide out in a monastery and then come out with bodyguards, talk about his faith, and then run back into his monastery. As Paul is in Athens, as Paul's in the city, he's walking around the city with broken, fragile, lost people. Imagine that. Matter of fact, he's actually learning about their city. He's learning about the people and the culture. He's looking, he's going to their temples. He's going into their, I don't know, in our day, he's going into their bars. I don't know what he's doing. But he's walking around. And he's going to the common everyday places to see why, where the heart of the people are at. What are the things that are valuable to them? What are their gods? Now, he was able to see statues. We have plenty of idolatry. We have stadiums full of idolatry. We have worship services with 50, 60, 70,000 people, millions of people watching it online. making huge offerings, billion-dollar business, giving their time, their energy, their money, their resources, sacrificing family for this idol, whatever it may be. It's called sports, just in case I make myself clear. Right? And they got all kinds, and they do all kinds of stuff. I mean, they got lights and stages and people dancing and unbelievable music. I mean, it's insane. Every culture has it. That's my point. And Paul addresses the problem with the culture, and I think that's going to be the main thing. In the marketplace, the reason why God's asked you and me to take the gospel into the out into the road is so that you and I would enter the marketplace. Whatever that may be, that might be your neighbor across the street, that might be in your community, that might be in your city, that might be at your job, I don't know where that might be, but where God has called you, that is where you and I take the gospel. That is where you and I go, and we reason in the marketplace. And see, what we see here is that Paul was grieved. He was grieved. And I want you to just kind of take a moment here. And I wonder if there's ever a time or a season in your life where, whether in your neighborhood, your community, in your city, your government, your nation, your workplace, where you walk around and you see things and hear things that grieve you. It's called the news. Or the newspaper. What? What in the world is going on in this world? What's going on in our nation? And there's something inside us that grieves. And see, what ends up happening is, what ends up happening to me many, many years ago, it's not really a good feeling. And so I don't want to feel grieved. I don't want to feel God's pain for the lostness of his children. I don't want to step into a mother, father's heart who's grieving over their child. I'm like, ooh, man, just even being in the room gets me all, oh, I mean, imagine actually stepping into that. And I get it, why you and I tend to back off. Because we don't want to experience that. And that's the reason why for many, many years, Eddie lived what I call a submarine Christian life. Because I didn't want to feel. I just tell me the ritual, tell me the ceremony, tell me how many scriptures I got to memorize, and just give me the little star and little check mark, and off I go, right? Don't tell me I got to, like, get involved or anything. And so I'd Sunday morning come along, get my little suit and tie on, my Bible in hand, and God bless you. Hallelujah. Yeah, victory. Yeah. Sunday morning, dive, man. Hanging out with the fellas, talking smack, no big deal. And I'm going to tell you, for Eddie, it was simply because I was just afraid. See, afraid of all the ridicule. I remember a couple of times talking about Jesus because I got ahead of myself and I got excited and went to work and, oh boy. And they were writing stuff on my coffee cup and writing stuff on my locker and making fun of me in front of roll call and blah, 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 blah. And I learned very quickly that when they sneer at you and they mock you, I have a tendency to back down. And then I allow the half-truths of culture to tell me, well, be sensitive. Don't offend anybody. You know, you don't want to hurt your feelings. Your feelings. Nobody cares about my feelings. Anyway, well, that's a different story. But anyway, right? And we're not addressing the problem of culture. We've just assimilated into the problem of the culture. And I can't tell you how long I did that. Here's Paul, and he was grieved. I'm going to tell you what's grieved. What's so grieving for Paul. He's walking around, and the things that God should have gotten the credit and the glory for, the culture was taking upon themselves. Like, you know, we create a beautiful dish for dinner. Ooh, look what I did. and never give thanks to God, the God who created the food, the God who created all the spices, the God who created the material for the pan, the God who created the universe with enough atoms for you to fire up that pan, and not one time do we give God glory for what? Now, yes, we shaped it, but we give ourselves glory for the buildings that we make and the cities that we build and the businesses that we make. And I'm saying, whoa, and God's nowhere is God recognized or thanked for the hands that he gave you, the strength that he gave in your body, the intellect that he gave you, the creativity to be able to think through all those businesses, for you even to create wealth. And never do we give him credit. And Paul walks around that city and he's grieved. And my friends, I understand why we don't want to grieve either, because it seems at times it's just so overwhelming. But I want you to see that you and I will be totally ineffective in God's hands as an instrument for him if you and I do not grieve over the lostness of people. We're not here to bash them or beat them or tell them how superior we are because, you know, God gave us a little light that we never created and we take the glory for. And then we go around bashing people. I want you to kind of see here in the story, here's Paul, he's grieved. He's going into the marketplace, and who does he see there? The Epicureans and the Stoics, the philosophers, the educators, the intellectuals. And then you say, well, that was in that day. I'm going to tell you, Athens was so much like, culturally, like us, who we are right here in the United States. What do I mean by that? Well, let's look at who these people are. Look at the Stoics. The Stoics were the moralists. They're the people that say, basically, hey, you know, don't cry, suck it up, you know what I mean, put a pair on, whatever terminology you like, you know, get over it. And ultimately, you know, don't worry about your pain and suffering and such. Just follow whatever code you come up with. You know, if, you know, this works very, very good for us military guys. You know, just there's a code. Live by this code, and you just suck it up, and you put everything aside, and you don't deal with it. You bury and you stuff, and you don't deal with issues. Right? You come from a military, law enforcement background, any type of uniform service. You have taught just stuff, stuff, stuff. See, the problem here, all the historians tell us that ultimately the Stoics faded from history because their ability to be able to help people deal with suffering didn't work. And see, suffering and injustice, okay, is prevalent to every generation, every culture, every human being on the planet. There isn't anybody who has not at one point experienced suffering and injustice. Well, let's look at how the Epicureans, they were what I would call the relativists in our day. They didn't believe in an afterlife. Just live for the moment. Do whatever you need to do to be happy, because your happiness is the most important thing. You are the center of the universe, and our job is to make you happy. Why? Because you deserve it. You earned it. You're entitled. We raise up a whole nation on that Epicurean and Stoic philosophy, haven't we? And what have we produced? What did the Athenians produce? The Athenians used to be a world power. Economically, politically, socially, militarily wise, they were the power of the day. Now the only thing left was Athens, and all they were known for was human ideas and effort. And they eventually decline, and it's a slippery slope. And I'm telling you, my friends, if you don't see that we are in the same slippery slope, believing all of these man-made wisdom and all these man-made ideas, because we've moved away from the God ideas. We moved away from the God ideas that had made this nation great, that had taken these little weak 13 colonies that had no political, no social, no economic influence at all, and they became, at one point in our history, the moral voice for the world. Now we're mocked all around the planet. I mean, I have three sons, right? They're all grown up. They're all men now. When my boys, I'm telling you how crazy when we go to human wisdom and we move away from God's wisdom, God ideas, okay? When my boys, when they were little and they were going to middle school or high school, and one of them would get sick, and you know, and they just had like a little scratchy throat, and I'd send them like an aspirin. You know, all my teachers and nurses, all right, school nurses. I send them an aspirin, you know, just so they can get, you know, they're not really bad, you keep them home, but you know, a little aspirin, they'll be fine, right? Oh, you don't send aspirin. We can't authorize or give an aspirin in school. It's, I mean, it's terrible, it's horrendous. Don't do it, don't send it. I get letters, I'm getting phone calls. It's an aspirin, for God's sake. Okay? This is how crazy it is. If I had a daughter, and if my daughter had gotten pregnant in middle school, and if she decided that she wanted to have an abortion, the school is not authorized to notify me and authorized to take her to get the abortion without my consent. Oh, look it up, friends. Oh, yeah. Crazy. That's insane. Human ideas and wisdom. We have slipped down the slippery slope. I'm going long. I'm sorry, man. This stuff just really irks me. I'm grieved. I was watching, my wife and I were watching the news this morning. I love California. In California, in these big institutions where you got all the biggest eggheads and the most intellectual guys with 15 doctorates, and they're teaching all kinds of stuff and all kinds of whatever. I mean, I think sometimes some people are educated beyond their intelligence, but whatever. Yeah, I mean, they got all the education on the planet, and there has a movement now on campus. They don't want to use the word he or she because it's offensive. You know, we want to be called Z. It's gender neutral. Okay, this morning on the news, I'm like, okay, friends, we got to get back to the book. We are losing a culture and a generation. And we got to get back in the marketplace. All right. Man, I took too much time there. All right. God. Turn with me, verse 24, and it says, "The God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth." And right now, okay, so I want you to see, Paul goes into the marketplace, he takes the gospel on the road, the first thing that he does, okay, doesn't talk about himself, don't talk about his church, don't talk about the ministries in his church, don't say, oh, we got the greatest children's church, we got the greatest youth ministry, we got the greatest worship team, forget about all that, okay? What Paul did, he says, listen, he pointed them to the power and the greatness of God. Boom, that's it. Everything else flows out of that. Okay, out of the fact of who God is, you can have all these great ministries and this and that and the other thing. That should not be the conversation to get people to come. The greatness of God, God's the answer to your problem. God heals, God delivers, God makes dry bones live. God rose from the dead. God is awesome. That is the message. Never did he get into the detail. Well, we got small groups going on, and we got a couple of Bible studies, and we do little ministries here and there, and we, you know, this is great. Maybe you can get connected to church by handing out toothpaste. Like, no. I want to tell you about the God, Almighty God, the creator of the universe, who loves you and is concerned about your eternal well-being. And see, the thing is, Paul reasoned. Let me give you this. In our mind, we go to this reasoning thing, and we think reasoning is just a cognitive exercise in our mind, I'm going to tell you that we don't understand the word properly. I'm not going to get into all that. But I want you to understand that when Paul reasoned, yes, he went and he gave them the evidence, okay, as we read here, the proof. He gave them the proof. And the proof was the resurrection. The proof was the greatness of God. The proof was that God is real, God exists, and that because God is real and God exists, you're pointing to him. That ultimately, that belief in God leads you and me to one thing. As we read here, God commands all men, all women, all children, everywhere to repent and say, I'm tired of following my own ways. I'm tired of going to my own wisdom. I'm tired of, my culture, my family, my... Now, see, what we don't understand the danger, even though we've experienced it in human history more times than we got fingers and toes, is that if there is no God, listen to me, if there is no God, then I have no right in my culture to go to your culture and tell you you're doing it wrong. What right would I have? We have fought world wars over cultures feeling superior over other cultures. Why? Because they have, like the Epicureans, they don't believe in God, they don't believe in any afterlife, and so the only thing then left is this world, and if all there is this world is then dog eat dog. We're all animals, and the one who's the biggest wins. And so you and I have no moral right, no moral conviction at all to go around and point to other cultures simply because that's how my family did it, that's how my culture did it, that's how our government does it, and so we're right and you're wrong. This is where the United, and this is my opinion, it's not the say of the Lord, it's my opinion, the United States, I believe, had the moral voice in the world when they didn't go and say, well, because we're Americans and we have the biggest economy and the biggest military might, we got nuclear weapons, and we are the movers and shakers socially and politically, and we think that you should do what we do, so be a democracy. How dare us? What moral right do we have as a culture, as a people, to go around telling other people what to do? And they're right and we're wrong. No. If you go back to our founding fathers, and you go back to many of our early leaders and presidents, the reason why when they went to war was because ultimately God's justice was violated. When we had wars with other countries, and the reason why we went back in and spent the quadrillion billion dollars to build them back up, why? Because God's word said, listen, we're supposed to love people. That gave us the moral voice, submitting ourselves to the word of God. Not our own personal cultural significance, our own, who has the biggest and loudest voice? Who could squeak the wheel more? And we're following the trends. But see, when you and I have a God, when you and I say there is an almighty God and we submit to that, then it's not me, not my culture, my society, my family upbringing. Okay, God then determines what is right and what is wrong, thus saith the Lord. Doesn't matter what culture. And Paul starts at heaven and earth. And that's how he starts off with these Epicureans, these Stoic philosophers, and he says, God is the God and Lord of heaven and earth, and everyone will bow a knee, and everyone will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Why? For your betterment and my betterment. Because once he tells us that, this is what ends up happening. Once God becomes God in our life, once we become a people of faith, then out of our love for God, guess what? We move out of me, myself, and I. The reason why we have war and sickness and pestilence, the reason why one culture goes over to another culture, one nation fights another nation, is because one nation or one group of people feels superior over the next, which is an absolute lie. And because we do that, the atrocities are endless. And you and I need to appreciate the fact how God is the one that begins to set the right and wrong in our life, and that is the reason why he's called us to love people. That is the reason why we feed the hungry and take care of widows and orphans. That's why we help single parents and family in need and pay the electric bill, and this is the reason why we change oil for people, and it's the reason why we have youth ministry and children ministry. It's the reason why we have worship, because we're pointing to the power and the greatness of God. This is an audience of one. And when we start making it about me, and well, I want everybody to wrap around me, and you know, everybody understand, you know, me, and listen, God has already poured out his affections on the cross, and he made it about you already. He said you're so of infinite value to him that he was willing to be abused and beaten and violated and rejected by his family and rejected by the whole world. Those who should have loved him, abandoned him. He made it about you already. Made a place in heaven, allowed you and me to be justified, sanctified, and glorified one day in him. He made it about you. Now he's saying, listen, out of your love for me, can you be secure enough to love your neighbor? Could you consider the needs of someone else more than your own, now that you know you are deathly secure in your Abba Father's hand? Now that you know that you are the most precious, you are the apple of his eye, that he rejoices over you with singing, that he has a banner of love over you. And when he created all of creation, the mountains, the stars, the forests, the waterfalls, you were the pinnacle of creation to him. Can you love? Verse 32, when they heard about the resurrection of the dead, some of them sneered, and I think right here is the hammer on the nail. He goes and he points to the power of God, and then he doesn't leave. This is the reasoning. He goes then and gives them proof, my friends. The resurrection is the proof. The resurrection is that every promise God has ever made in this book, that everything that he's ever said to you, that he has the power, the ability, the resources, and the desire to fulfill them in your life and my life. And so the reasoning not only goes here, that he begins to challenge our premises that either we feel superior and why, you know, that I think the world should revolve around me and it should all be about me. And he reasons with them and says, listen, you got all these idols and all these things and it's all about you, but let me just tell you. And he reasons with them, to prove to them, to say, listen, don't do that. And then the reasoning goes further down. This is why it's reasoning. See, if it wasn't reasoning, if he was just proclaiming, he'd be lecturing them about, you know, the moral superiority of his way of life over your way of life. Sometimes that might work for some people, but Paul wasn't lecturing about moral superiority at all. He reasoned, and the reasoning was that he was going to them, challenging the thinking, the culture of the day, the philosophy, all the half-truths and lies that were now promoted as true, and all the things that were true are now promoted as lies. And he went, and he gave them the proof of the resurrection. This is why they sneered, because it wrecked their heart. And my friends, if the gospel doesn't wreck our hearts, we have not understood it. The gospel of Jesus Christ wrecks our heart. We begin to feel the Father's heart. And it hurts, my friends. And it's not easy. And we want to push away. And I get that. But see, to align our heart with God's heart means that the things that matter to him matter to us. And that's the reason why we don't go around and bully people and violate their humanity and mock them. And whether they live for God or don't live for God, whether we like their behavior or don't like their behavior, God didn't ask us to do any of that. That's lecturing moral superiority. Get rid of that religion. And follow and be, as we learned before, a man or a woman after God's own heart. And God's going to bring justice at the end. It's not you and me doing that. It's the Holy Spirit's job to bring conviction, not you and me to do that either. God's given you and me a job to love people. And he's going to produce the outcome. And I want to suggest to you that Paul walked in the steps of his master, Jesus. He didn't testify about himself, his church, ministries, this, that, and the other thing. Oh, what a great little community we are. I mean, you know, you get a little toothbrush and a card to the bathroom, and you're one of the in the crowd, and in our little club. Forget about that. He pointed them to the power and the majesty and the greatness of our God. Jesus and the resurrection, crucified. And then he led them and showed them and said, listen, the reasoning of God's word was going to wreck your heart. And it's going to wreck my heart so that we finally go and put the gospel on the road. He gives them the proof of the resurrection. And I want you to see that the reason why, that he's already proven to us that he made it the cross about you and me. It's already about us. And then he says, I want you to live greater than you. I want you to accomplish greater things than I can accomplish. I want you to be a world changer. I want you to live like the king and priest that you were made to be. I want you to understand that you're going to be seated in heavenly places, and I want you to go out and love people and love them in their culture. Learn their culture. Don't participate in the sinful aspect, but learn who they are. Love them. So that one day in your patience, in your long suffering, in your mercy and grace, that they would one day become trophies of grace. You see, and as we love people, see, almost 30 years ago, somebody loved me. And I was not a trophy of grace. I was a mean, nasty son of a boo boo boo. And that person continued to love me until eventually, out of their patience and allowing God to work, I became a trophy of God's grace. And I know that God wants you to use you because he loves you and you're so valuable, that one day when we see him face to face, that around that throne are going to be tons of trophies of grace because of your faithfulness. And that person will be standing there worshiping God because you loved them and you were able to invest in them. And I want us to see that God's called us to be on mission to raise up trophies of grace. And there's only people that are going to be reached for Jesus. It's only you're going to be able to do it. And I can't encourage you enough to invite you to that. Let's all stand. Ran out of time, but man, this is so stuck in my heart because it's been driving me for 30 years. And many times I've got it wrong. Many times I lectured people on moral superiority, and I'd scream at them and shame them and guilt them and all kinds of things. I'm telling you, that is not what the gospel has called us to do. It's called us to love people. And I want to encourage you today that you have the great love that God has for you. You are world changers for God, like a Paul. We're not running from the culture. We're engaging it for the glory of God. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you, Lord, for the trophies of grace in this room. I thank you, Lord, for the sacred privilege you've given us to be able, Lord, to love our spouses, our children, our parents, our family members, our neighbors, our co-workers, our city, our nation, and the world for you. And Father, we pray, Lord, that we would be a generation that goes out and we look and we are patiently on our knees, making it, Father, about you and your greatness and pointing them to you, oh God, that you would raise up trophies of grace all around our city. And we would be the light and the salt. We'd be the head, not the tail. I thank you, Lord, in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. God bless you. Have a wonderful day.